Welcome to Wargaming Recon. I am your host, Jonathan J. Reinhardt. Wargaming Recon is the longest running tabletop gaming podcast on the planet. I know this sounds like myself, but it's true, I assure you. This is episode 166, Gladius Publications with Henry Hyde. For all of you who are new and longtime listeners alike, I want to let you know about one thing. We talk about a lot of things on the show, and there's no way you can remember them all. You like to listen to podcasts while you're commuting, you're painting figures, you're doing all sorts of stuff. No one sits at a computer anymore and listens to a podcast, or at least I don't. So it's hard to remember everything. I try to make it easy for you. You only have to remember one thing, the link to the show notes where we have all sorts of stuff that we cover. Remember wargamingrecon.com/WR166. That's wargamingrecon.com/WR166, and that'll have all the things you need. So without further ado, I want to welcome our very, very special guest. I'm talking about, of course, the one and only Mr. Henry Hyde, and I could go on and list all the things he's done, but really, then the show would be over because he's such a talented individual, and he's doing this new adventure here that I am very excited about, and I think a lot of you will be as well. If you are not familiar with it, you will become very familiar soon. So Henry, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much indeed, Jonathan. It's great to be here.
I can't tell you how excited I was when I first heard you were going into publishing on your own with Gladius Publications. I think it's a perfect fit for you.
Thank you very much. That's the first thing. The thing is, it's initially it had a specific purpose for me to self-publish my own material, because as you know, and you've probably noticed just in the last few days, I also am trying to write fiction as well as wargaming stuff. And initially my thoughts were that Gladius Publications would be an outlet for me to do purely my own stuff, to self-publish my own fiction when it's finished. Let's steady on, everyone, it's not finished yet. To publish my own fiction and to publish other kind of non-fiction works besides it, you know, not necessarily anything to do with wargaming, but kind of military history, and then obviously some wargaming stuff. Although I'm having to think hard about that, because as you know, I've already got contracts with Pen and Sword, the publishers here in the UK, to write, I think it's three more books for sure at the moment, with possibilities of a fourth. There's, for a number of reasons, life has become quite, I tried to simplify it, but it's become more complicated recently. I need to tell a bit of backstory, and then we can sort of move on with the Gladius. Just recently, a couple of months ago, I made a momentous decision regarding Miniature War Games, the magazine, the monthly magazine that I edit, as you know. And that decision was that I would relinquish doing the design and layout work in the magazine as a step in the direction of freeing myself up to be able to pursue more of my own creative projects. One of the problems I've had since the days of Battle Games, which obviously Battle Games got sold to Atlantic Publishers back in 2011, and then Atlantic Publishers sold the combined Miniature War Games with Battle Games onto Warner's Publications last year, about, 15, 16 months ago now. And the problem has been, as we've discussed previously, that when you are the editor and designer of a monthly magazine, man, that's a lot of work. And I've been working some really crazy hours. And on top of those really crazy hours, I've been trying to continue with my own creative projects, whether that's writing more war games books or anything else. And it just reached the point where, man, it was killing me. I mean, almost quite literally, my health had been taking some hits, and I was having to, you know, whoa, this isn't good for me. And so it's a difficult decision, because obviously doing the design and layout of the magazine is reasonably lucrative. But I decided that if I was ever going to make any progress with my other creative projects, I needed to take a deep breath and jump off the edge of the cliff, basically. You know, in terms of what I lost in income when I made this decision a couple of months ago, you know, we're talking about £1,300 or £1,400 a month. So what's that? $1,500, $1,600. I'm not sure what the exchange rate is. Maybe a little bit more. Which, you know, to some people, wow, that's a wage in itself. And it is. I mean, when you've got a mortgage to pay and bills and, you know, credit cards and that kind of stuff to pay off, it's kind of mad. You know, it's so I've either been very brave, Jonathan, or I've been really stupid. And time will tell. Okay, so initially a bit of headspace to think about, right, well, how am I going to take things forward? And if I'm going to be doing things other than, you know, everyone knew me as the editor of Miniature War Games and knows me as that, but if I'm creating, doing this other thing, I need to have a brand effectively to do this. Now, it just so happens that, well, I've been a graphic designer for 26 years, and a very brief potted history was that I became a graphic designer back in 1991. And was in partnership with someone else. I was in a business partnership, and we grew our business to be one of the most successful agencies in this town, Brighton and Hove, on the south coast of England. And around about 1996, I started doing websites. And so we created another brand called HAY. So it was HA Design, Henry and Andrew, that's original, isn't it? HA Design. And then HA Wired was sort of the digital arm. And I kind of took over leadership of that and actually set up a second office to deal with this kind of thing. And then at the end of 1999, I split with my business partner. We were just like a band who played too many gigs together, you know. And so then it was weird because it was a very gentlemanly split, and we said, well, you know, he can carry on calling that his business HA Design. I could carry on calling mine HA Wired. But it's a bit like the house that never got sold after the divorce, you know. And I felt like, oh, you know, it was good at its time, but I'm also doing more paper-based design as well, and it doesn't really fit me anymore. Brought in a kind of a business consultant, a very, you know, bright woman who was full of ideas, very helpful. And she suggested to me, well, you know, HA Wired is great, you know, in terms of if you're only delivering a digital product or service, then that's great because, you know, the logo even had sort of lots of email and internet symbols in it and stuff. But the thing is, you're also doing other things. So what you need to do is get away from having a brand that's talking about what you do and creating a brand that's basically an expression of you as a person. Because effectively, when you're self-employed, your customers are buying you as much as they're buying your product or service, right? So it was around about that time that the movie Gladiator had come out. People may remember Gladiator. It was quite a famous movie. And so that was, you know, I realized that movie spoke to me on many levels. And so what I did was I came up with the name Gladius, which is obviously the name of the Roman sword that, you know, the Roman soldiers and gladiators used. And that kind of stuck, and I really enjoyed working with that name, and it was intriguing for customers. It got a conversation going, you know, like, oh, you know, where's that word come from and all the rest of it. So that was kind of good. But, you know, along with that was that, you know, moving fast forward to kind of the early 2000s, the idea of Battle Games magazine was born, you know, around about 2004 2005, and then obviously the first issue of Battle Games came out 2006, and the Gladius, you know, that took over my life. So the Gladius brand, you know, I had a few existing clients, I carried on doing bits and pieces for them, but essentially that kind of got put on the shelf. So just recently, you know, what with this decision, this momentous decision to pursue, you know, a more creative life, and I was, you know, it just smacked me around the head. You know, don't go trying to create another brand. Don't reinvent the wheel. You've already got one. So all I did really was brought out and dusted off that Gladius brand and just changed. It was originally Gladius Creative Communication, and I just changed it to Gladius Publications. The kind of brand was born. And I count myself lucky because I know, because I've designed lots of corporate identity people, that, you know, that's a process that can take weeks or months to come up with, you know, the right corporate identity, whereas, you know, it just slapped me upside the head straight away. So that was kind of an afternoon's work as opposed to a month's work. So that I managed to get off the ground. And then, you know, my advice to anyone is, the moment these days you have an idea, go out and buy the domain names and all that kind of stuff, set up the Twitter account, set up the Facebook page and all that. So you probably noticed, you along with, you know, several hundred other people, noticed kind of overnight, like, blimey, what's all this Gladius stuff that's appeared? Facebook pages and Twitter accounts and what have you. Hey, and I got a mailing list going as well, which is now already, without me doing anything really, has already got, I think, 300 subscribers on it. Which is, you know, nowhere near the level I want it to be, but man, 300 subscribers when I've basically done no marketing whatsoever is, you know, fairly astonishing. You know, people buy online courses, how to get your first 100 mailing list subscribers, and I got 300, you know, almost overnight. So, no, that's fantastic, and obviously I'm really, really grateful to those people who have signed up, because you know, from the point of view of anyone starting a new enterprise, it's obviously, you know, when you've got that level of support before you've done anything really, that's fantastic, because that is a sign that you have a core support group. These are people who are really keen on what you're going to produce. They're really interested in what you're doing. And also, you know, it's like when I first started Battle Games Magazine, I think I've told you, nowadays we'd call it a Kickstarter. But I did, you know, Kickstarter didn't exist. So what I did was I pre-sold subscriptions to the magazine. You know, it was the old school wargaming group, and you know, they, to be honest, they'd encouraged me to do Battle Games as a project. So I said to them, look, I've got no money. Can you help out? And I can't remember, it was someone piped up and said, oh, you know, well, why don't we do what's in fact a very old-fashioned idea, you know, centuries old, this idea of pre-subscribing to a book or pamphlet or something of that kind to cover the costs in setting it up. So, I can't remember, it was about 100, 150 people, something like that, actually put their hands in the pockets and helped me get Battle Games off the ground, which was fantastic. And so, in a sense, this is kind of a very similar thing. When there's 300 people, they're basically saying, look, we're sitting here, we're waiting, sell us something. And believe me, folks, I'm working on that. I really am. So, that's kind of how the genesis of the Gladius Publications thing. And it was, the idea was, yeah, it was going to be my stuff. And obviously, when you're doing something like this and you've made the decision to kiss goodbye to quite a substantial chunk of income, your immediate concerns is, well, okay, what can I do to bring in money as quickly as possible? So, I did two things. I did a series of kind of map squares, terrain squares that you've probably seen, that was a giveaway for people who joined up on the mailing list, which seemed to go down quite well. So I did a second volume. Basically, I did a load more with more, you know, forests and trees and roads and hills and whatnot, and put that on as kind of the first standalone product. And, you know, people have been buying that, you know, not in vast numbers. Let's not get carried away here, but it's very gratifying to see. But that's not, you know, I did that because I know I can do the graphics. And it was an idea that, in fact, I'd first done in my book, The Wargaming Compendium. I'd actually done a page of, you know, terrain square ideas so that newcomers to the hobby could get an idea of, well, if you're buying terrain squares, these are the sort of permutations that will be on them. Idea, because it, you know, this is why I did it for Gladius. It suddenly dawned on me, oh, actually they could have a life kind of on their own. So that was cool. But obviously what I want to do is more written stuff, you know, words are my thing. But in the meantime, as soon as people got wind of the fact that, oh, you know, Henry's available, that kind of thing, I immediately got some emails and phone calls, which was great, from other people in the industry who I can't say, unfortunately, yet, though it will become known, who basically said to me, oh, look, well, actually, Henry, we've got this project and that project. Would you be interested in helping out? Obviously, for money. And I, you know, I thought about 5 seconds and thought, yeah. So at the moment, I'm actually in the process of laying out a set of rules for someone that I can't reveal yet. I've been invited to do a part of a for someone. And also, funnily enough, going way back to the days when I was originally using Gladys as a brand, I bumped into one of my old clients from about 15 years ago, who said, for whom I'd actually designed his corporate identity and his website. And he said, oh God, Henry, thank God I bumped into you. I want someone to update my website, but I don't trust anyone except you, which is like, you know, that's really touching. That's lovely. I didn't have the heart to tell him that, oh, really, do you know, I don't really want to be doing website work, but hey, I need the money. So I've got that as well to do. So that's great. But then what I really didn't expect at all, people started emailing me saying, oh, Henry, if you're going to be publishing stuff, would you consider publishing my stuff? Which was like, oh, crikey. So in other words, would, and I mean, to you on the outside, it probably seems obvious, but to me, duh, I hadn't imagined that anyone else would want me to publish their stuff. Right. So yeah, I am in negotiation with and moving forward with, well, it's now 3 people I'm in discussions with. I'm quite certain there may well be more, and I've made it clear what the deal is. You know, I'm not a big publishing company. I can't afford to pay advances, and we can come back to that, but there's other reasons why advances these days are, you know, they're not what they used to be. But the deal I've offered to people is, right, I'll pay 25% royalties, and you know, because I know most publishing companies do virtually no marketing for authors these days, as I know to my cost. So, you know, I'll help you with the marketing, and obviously I'll produce a nice product. The product will be primarily digital, so it may be PDF or, you know, Kindle or iBook or, you know, whatever format. And potentially print on demand. That will depend title by title, but obviously nowadays with Amazon Create Space, you can upload a title which then gets sold via Kindle, but also people can buy it print on demand, just one copy at a time, which is one of the amazing things about these days. So, and they've all said, yeah, fine. which obviously, as a businessman, that leads me to think, rats, I offered them too much money. But no, I'm happy about that, because I feel like that's giving them a fair deal, but it also means that I'll be earning enough out of it to justify the time, obviously, I've got to put into doing the design and layout of these things, and the editing and that kind of stuff, and maybe paying for a proofreader, that kind of stuff. So, yeah, I kind of wasn't expecting that, but obviously, useful income stream. Two of the people I can reveal I'm talking to at the moment, one is Mick Zace. His full name is A. Michael Zace. I've never asked him what the A stands for, actually. Probably Anthony or something, isn't it? But A. Michael Zace, who readers of Miniature War Games will remember, I hope, because he's written loads of articles about the Mongols and also wrote an article a while ago about painting 10 millimeter miniatures and making scenery for 10 mil or was it 6 mil miniatures and stuff. So he's quite well known and highly respected, particularly for his Mongol work. So yeah, that's been kind of fascinating, really. That these other people want me to do their stuff as well. So yeah, that's kind of groovy.
It almost sounds like maybe you're going to be even busier with your new venture than before, but probably a little more of an ebb and flow sort of setup.
Yeah, well, it's the thing is that what I need in order to pursue my creative work, what I need is what's in the trade called a passive income. You know, if I was extremely wealthy, that would be money I've got in the bank that's earning interest and, you know, hey, I'm just living off the interest. I don't actually have to do any real work at all. Wouldn't that be lovely? But the thing about digital products, what I can tell you, people are still buying Battle Games Issue 1 via my Payhip site, which is now, man, that's 10 years ago. You know, March 2006 is more than 10 years ago, which to me is astonishing. But people still, because there's a lot of people in the world, are still stumbling upon it going, hey, what's this? I've never seen this before. And some of them, once in a while, are even going, oh, my God, and there's 30 issues, and they buy the lot. And so suddenly my PayPal account goes, ka-ching! I say, wow, that's handy. You know, and I sometimes wake up in the morning and there's already some money in my account, which is just fantastic. You know, this is what online, you know, some people would call it monetizing, but online trading, this is what it's all about, where essentially you set something up, you do the work once, but then it carries on paying you potentially forever, you know. Whereas when you're a graphic designer, you know, when I'm doing the design and layout for Miniature War Games, obviously they pay me a design fee per issue. And for other clients, I get paid by the hour or by the day. So you can only get paid as much as, you know, the hours you can literally work in a day. And if you're prepared to, as I have on many occasions over the years, if you're prepared to sometimes work 24 hours a day because you need the money, then obviously, you know, you earn more, but at the same time, you're killing yourself, quite literally. So that's not a sensible way to go about things. So the this is, you know, the core idea of Gladys was to do two things, was to give me an outlet for my own self-published work, so to help produce a passive income. And I've been thinking, you know, out of the box, thinking around the subject, and it dawned on me that another way that I can also kind of expand that idea is by providing online courses. And so you may have seen a cryptic Facebook post, a post of mine a couple of weeks ago, whatever, when I first had that kind of ding, eureka moment with a new adaptation of the logo, Gladius Academy. Idea being that it would be to provide high quality, high value courses for people who really want to learn how to do something, not really as a hobby, because obviously this is the other thing you encounter. There's loads of YouTube videos and stuff out there, and other sites like Udemy and that kind of stuff, where you can download, you know, how to tie your shoelaces or whatever it might be, you know. Short videos, even some of them quite long, you know, might be an hour long, on how to do something specific in a piece of software or whatever. Whereas, you know, and so there's no value. There's no point me, you know, recreating the wheel and duplicating something and expecting something, people to charge for something that they'll just turn and say, well, hang on, Henry, I can already get this for free. Thank you very much indeed. And so, you know, I've had a big brainstorm with myself, and obviously I've come up with ideas. Oh, I could show people how to paint war games miniatures and that kind of thing. But hello, there's loads of really good videos out there already. There's loads of tutorials in magazines. Christy at War Game Soldiers and Strategy, you know, she's got done a whole series of YouTube videos, and they're really good, man. You know, if she's watching, hi Christy. But they are, they're really good. And so, you know, who would want to watch me, Henry Hyde, editor, teach it? Well, this is how. Here's a 12-step course to painting War Games miniatures. You know, and it's $200. And you're going to go, thanks, Henry, bye. So, no. You know, I've had wargaming friends who've kind of picked up on the fact I'm doing this, who've sent me a lot of helpful suggestions, and 99% of them I've looked at and gone, nah, no, no, because it's already available out there for free. The areas that I'm probably going to be doing something or doing the teaching around, I've got to tell you now, from what I can tell, they're not going to have anything to do with wargaming. They may have something to do with military history. I mean, there is a potential for doing a course of, you know, military history for dummies or something of that kind, but more specifically aimed at a target market, perhaps like writers, you know, fellow writers who are self-publishing, or they want to move from being romance writers into historical fiction writers or whatever. So that's something I might do. But, you know, there are things, you know, I've been a graphic designer for all these years. So I do have very marketable skills. And there are people out there who think, right, well, you know, actually, I'd like to be a graphic designer or learn how to save money by being able to use graphic design tools in my business, or to help me, you know, create and publish my own works, you know, to self-publish. So it's more likely you're going to see me coming up with courses to do with, you know, how to use Adobe InDesign and Photoshop to design your own self-published book, you know, and then upload it to Amazon and all the rest of it. Because there are other bits of software. There's a piece of software called Scrivener that you may have heard of, where there's a guy called Joseph Michael, who's a great bloke, and he does a fantastic course on Scrivener, you know, kind of Scrivener for dummies, or how to learn Scrivener fast, something like that. So he's already done Scrivener, so it's like I think I'm going to be looking at a more specific professional level software like Adobe InDesign and Photoshop, that kind of stuff. Where, you know, there might be someone in the war games field who's interested, who happens to, you know, at the moment they just use Photoshop for sharpening and brightening their photos of their miniatures, but they also might have some kind of association in the print trade, or be thinking of branching out, having a career change into graphic design, that kind of stuff. So, but that's also the kind of thing where someone will think, yeah, I don't mind paying, you know, a few hundred dollars for that, because that's going to help me to earn a few thousand dollars every year, right? And also, it's the kind of thing I could, if you're charging a few hundred dollars for a course, you can make it more affordable by saying to people, if you pay me up front, it's $300, or you can pay me $50 a month for 12 months or whatever, you know, to help make it more affordable for you. So that's kind of where the Gladius Academy ideas, you know, whirling around, and writing, you know, some people I put out a call on the Gladius Facebook page, you know, hey guys, you know, this is an idea I've got. What kind of courses would you be interested in having? And again, there was quite an interesting mixture. One of them was writing war games rules, which is, well, how long's a piece of string, you know? It's quite interesting. But there was the writing thing came up several times from different people, writing with clarity or writing business reports, that kind of stuff. So who knows? And obviously your listeners and viewers, if they have any amazing ideas this is where I have to say, you know, that they think specifically they would like to hear from me, you know, what is it that Henry Hyde you think could teach people, give better value than someone else teaching it, you know, because of my unique experience, you know, in graphic design, business, magazine editing, and writing in general, rather than just, oh, Henry, could you do a course on flower arranging? Guys. I can see you're imagining it, Jonathan. Oh.
I think you're spot on though with the I'm sorry, with it's so professional of me with the passive income though. I do that on a very, very small scale, you know, for the show here. I put episodes up on Wargame Vault, and people can choose to they pay what they want, basically, because I kind of feel weird charging people for my show. One of my ethos for here, and this is because I have a regular full, you know, 9-to-5 kind of job, but I feel this should be free for people. Not that it doesn't have value. I think it has immense value for the right person, but in general, I don't want to say, like, you need to pay me a membership fee in order to get into my membership site to get this. But at the same time, if someone wants to, you know, send a little something my way as thanks, for me, the passive income is kind of the best. So people can pay whatever they want on Wargame Vault, and they get episodes, and they've have. So I'll get these sales notifications all the time, and often they'll say, oh, you know, they just got it for free, which is great, because I like to spread the word, and I like to think, should I ever flip the switch and go, well, maybe I will dump my 9-to-5 and make a go of it as doing, which I would love to do someday. Is it realistic? Probably not. But I'm building up that audience. And then also, not as passive per se, but the whole Patreon kind of thing for me has worked really well. Between that and having a sponsor for the show, no matter how many episodes I put out, the money's there. The money comes in every month. My backers on Patreon, it comes in and so forth. And I mean, there's that trust involved where I'm going to have to produce something for them. And but at the same time, like, it shows up like clockwork. It comes in, I see it, it goes on the account and so forth. And it's nice to have that because, again, it's a completely different environment than, like, you needed to pay your bills. I needed to keep the show going. And if the show doesn't go, like, you know, that's that. It'd be sad, but I'm not going to get evicted from my house for didn't do whatever.
I think you mentioned Patreon there. That is a really interesting model. And I think it definitely works for things like podcasts and vidcasts. There's a name that I often mention when Neil Shuck and I are chatting on View from the Veranda, a woman called Joanna Penn, who you may well have heard of, goes under the brand of the Creative Pen for her nonfiction work. And she is just phenomenally productive in the field of self-publishing and that kind of stuff. And she runs a podcast based on Patreon. She has Patreon supporters. Now, because she's got, several tens of thousands of visitors to her website, her Patreon income is quite substantial. I'm not sure what level it's up to now, but it's certainly, you know, in the probably thousands of dollars per month, which is hugely impressive, obviously. And I think for things that are appearing regularly, like a podcast or a vidcast, it's a thing that works well because people feel like, yeah, well, that's fair enough. I support her. You know, I think, you know, I can't remember what I'm actually sponsoring her for, but I don't know, $10 a month or whatever it is, you know, because I think she does a podcast every single week and sometimes two. And I'm thinking they're all really good top level stuff with, you know, she's interviewing amazing people who always, you know, I listen to come away having scribbled a load of notes because, man, that's really useful. That's really interesting. Oh, I didn't know that. Wow, gosh, you know, glad I didn't miss that. So I think in that kind of sense, you know, Patreon's a good model because it feels, as a customer, if you like, it feels like, yeah, I'm paying a subscription and I don't mind that. I think it's more difficult for people like myself who are just, you know, hey guys, please send me some money every month so I can be just generally creative. Yeah, wouldn't that be lovely? Perhaps I should try it, Jonathan. Just stick a Patreon button on my blog or something.
Hey, I mean, you never know. I know an independent musician. He actually is the one who's created the theme song that I use. And he has a Patreon campaign. He gets about $900 per item that goes out. And if he were to switch it to per month, he'd be about $1,500 to $2,000 a month. And his items are songs. And he's going to release albums. He does whole albums this way instead of the other. He self-releases all of them. He does really well. He tours, I mean, and that kind of stuff too. But for him, this has worked really well. And I've talked to him about it because I was kind of curious. And he lives generally local to me in the New England area. And he kind of just views it as, these are people who like what I'm doing. They get me, is the phrase he kind of likes to use. Yeah. And they want to support him no matter what. So whether it's buying his stuff or just allowing him to create the things. And so they support. And I mean, I backed them too for a while. And so it's working really well for him. And this is how he pays his bills. So I was kind of intrigued by that it's worked for him like that. And I could see it working for other types of people, other types of creatives, not necessarily everyone. Cause like you said, it varies for the return on investment, so to speak, for people and for what your supporters are going to feel like. Are they going to feel it's worth it waiting, you know, months for a new book to come out? Well, maybe if you release chapters from time to time or that kind of stuff, sneak peeks.
I think you've touched on something there. I think if I was a short story writer, and so I produce kind of monthly episodes or something like that, or monthly stories, I think that's probably an acceptable model. I haven't really looked into it, but I wouldn't surprise me if I discovered that there are writers who do that, if they're primarily short story writers as opposed to novelists, that they could potentially have success with Patreon. Because I know a lot of novelists, I know a lot of self-published novelists and non-fiction writers now, and mostly what they do is they're selling complete books. So they may well have links on their blog or site or whatever linking to their book, either to buy direct from them or via Amazon or iTunes or whatever it happens to be, but I haven't yet, and it is only yet, I haven't yet come across anyone who's earning money, you know, based on a Patreon income for smaller, shorter works of fiction. What tends to happen is that people will use short works of fiction as a teaser to kind of prime people for the novel that's coming. So I have seen writers, for example, write a short story based around one of their central characters to kind of sell that character to the potential readers so that they're going, oh, wow, you know, this guy sounds intriguing. You know, I want to find out more about them. Well, you can find out more in the complete novel when it's published, you know, in November 2017 or whatever. But there's going to be a gap between you reading this little, you know, the final thing. So that's kind of tricky. The other thing, ways that I'm also looking at this, which is, example, in software, in Adobe InDesign or Photoshop, what you can do is create templates for people to use for designing and laying out their book. There is a guy, and I think his URL is actually thebookdesigner.com, Joel Freelander, that's his name. He's an American guy who's been around for a long time and very cleverly, you know, grabbed that domain name and made a niche for himself several years ago now. It's quite a few years ago. But there's no one in the UK doing that. So effectively, I could be the British Joel Freelander providing a similar kind of service. Because it's one of those cultural things, isn't it, that a lot of online courses and stuff that, you know, obviously come with a national style, and you guys over in America, you tend to be really kind of gung-ho and yeah, let's do it kind of thing. Whereas we British are often a bit more restrained, a bit more kind of circumspect. And so what, I think there might be a market for is a slightly more kind of or a less frantic approach, shall we say. Still enthusiastic, but just kind of toned down slightly. So, yes, we're encouraging, we're nurturing, but we're not necessarily, you know, claiming that, man, we're out to conquer the world here. You know, it's like, really? All I want is a book template, mate. You know, do me a favor. But I'm sure I don't have to tell you, there are people like this out there. I think the thing is, it's like, a lot of people like to take courses or learn things without feeling like they're buying life insurance, right? Because you know, I used to be a life insurance salesman, and I can remember the first company I worked for. I think they've gone bust now, actually. But I think it was either an American or Canadian company. I think it might be Canadian. But their training, their sales training, was all really gung ho, and they wanted everyone to get up and stand on the desks and do all that kind of, you know. What's his name? Harold Robbins stuff, isn't it? The motivational speaker. So I think there is a niche for people who want just a slightly calmer environment. We shall see. But obviously, if you have any great ideas of things that you think, well, heck, I'd pay Henry to learn that, man, let me know.
I think you've hit something, though, with the online courses. I've done a lot of the lynda.com ones. They're owned by LinkedIn now, and they talk about, you know, all sorts of stuff. It's very involved kind of coursework, and I do it through work, so it doesn't cost me anything because my employer has a whole, you know, thing set up. And I know other podcasters who've done this sort of thing, too, to teach search engine optimization and WordPress stuff and all that kind of thing. And they've found that it's not people like me who are doing it, it's companies who are doing it, and it's the professionals, and that's really where they've kind of pivoted to, so that they can still do whatever else they're doing, but that they're reaching these customers who have a huge need for it. So it helps them, they're able to help other people and share the knowledge, and then they do get the, you know, every so often the everyday kind of guy or woman who is coming in and wants to do this sort of stuff. The people I've spoken to who've created these kind of things, they've said it's been very rewarding, a lot more time intensive than they would have thought. And I think that for me, the thing that's kind of interesting is the different ways that the people have approached it. So like you have that lynda.com kind of perspective where it's a video tutorial basically, but you follow along. There's a script, there's worksheets and so forth. Some of the very well-known podcasters out there, they'll do a whole kind of interactive chat sort of thing so that they have the video you watch. It's almost like doing a live streaming event. So you kind of have these different methods. And then when your live stream is done, you get the recording and you can keep and use that forever. Others do sort of a mastermind sort of setup where they have this whole mastermind group, but you pay to get into it. And then you have all this sort of stuff that then becomes available for you, all these online classes and so forth. So many different ways to do it. And I don't think there's any really wrong way. It just kind of depends on what you want to do and who you want to reach. And you're going to get people definitely. Yeah,
I think this is the thing, though, Jonathan, that, well, first of all, you mentioned lynda.com. Man, I remember when they first started, and they were the guys producing all the really big, thick, kind of missing manual things for your computer software. They've been around. Well, since the 1990s, that's for sure. So you've got a pedigree, you know, high impressive. I think you hit on another thing there, which is where saying that the audience quite often for technical matters isn't the general public, it's businesses. It's businesses who want to train their staff to be able to do stuff. And the other thing about businesses, they're prepared to pay a much bigger price tag than Joe Schmo, right? So that's something I am kind of thinking about. I can't remember what the third thing was. So back to you, Jonathan. You said something else there.
The mastermind groups, which is, I mean, some of them are free, some are, but it's kind of the same sort of setup where you get into this sort of club almost, and you're able to have, I guess the closest thing for people who aren't familiar with it would be if you're an author, you join kind of like a mutual critique group where you share what you're working on, you made this progress and that kind of stuff, or group therapy, I guess, for people and that sort of thing. But you know, for the specific purpose of whatever it is you're creating, whether it's you're a graphic designer, you're a web programmer or whatever, and you get into, or there's a lot for podcasters, and you get into that kind of setup and you have the support, but then you get access to all these extra resources, which is kind of cool too. I hear you, Seagull.
This is welcome to the coast, man. You know, this is Brighton and Hove. I'm about, less than a mile from the sea here. So we get lots of seagulls nesting on the roof just outside here. I'm pointing, but there's seagulls nests on the roof out there. But anyway, the other interesting thing, you know, sort of kind of wrapping up the Gladius thing, because people are probably sick of it by now, is that with all these other ideas, obviously, passive income. The challenge for me is making sure that I don't get completely sidetracked into, you know, publishing all this stuff for other people and doing all these other things. And then I end up with, well, man, what happened to that time I wanted for myself to do my own creative writing? So, yeah, I've been kind of working away at a novel for a long time, or a series of novels, in fact. And to be honest, with all kinds of pressures and stuff that I can't go into at the moment, but, you know, job pressures and things, it's been a real struggle to kind of do my own writing. And I'd kind of, I had a novel that I'd written quite a large chunk of. I can't remember if we've discussed in the past, but I'd written about, 40,000 words, 30 or 40,000 words of a novel that was intended to be the opening novel of a series. And it was an idea that I had the germ of a long time ago. I mean, we're talking probably 20 years ago. That's when the first germ of it came. And I kind of knocked it around and I'd kind of sat down, smacked out a big chunk of this novel, probably, 15 years ago now. And the trouble it was, and often is for authors, that if you start work on something and then put it to one side, when you then come back to it, you realize, do you know what? I'm not sure I'm so interested in this anymore. And the reason in my case was quite simply that the person I'd had as the lead character in the novel, when I reread it through with the intention of kind of getting it going again, I think my first reaction was, this guy's a jerk. You know, it was a character that suited me when I was a younger man, you know, in my kind of 20s, 30s, 40s, whatever. But now I'm 55. I looked at this guy and thought, you know, this isn't the person whose story I want to tell anymore. It's a very different person whose story I want to tell, because also, over the years, of course, you get influenced by so many other things, the movies you watch, the books you read, the other stuff you get interested in. And I was interested in an older, kind of much darker character. You know, let's not say it's autobiographical, because my lead character does some things that probably would be illegal, you know, chopping people's heads off left, right and center. But it definitely needed rewriting. So I kind of, it's a few months ago now, earlier this year, I sat down and completely re-outlined the novel. And I think this is the other thing that made a difference, because the first time I tried writing this story, I was doing it entirely by the seat of my pants. You know, I was definitely a pantser, as it's called in the trade, and I hadn't outlined at all. It was literally sit down and just smack out as many words as possible and see how far I can get with it. So actually, it's quite impressive I got as far as I did, but it was also the explanation of why I kind of ran out of steam, and what happened was the plot had gone off in all sorts of directions and I had far too many characters to deal with, and it was just, you know, classic kind of beginner's first novel syndrome.
It kind of sounds like George R. R. Martin.
Well, you know, exactly. The difference is that he and Stephen King, he's another famous pantser, has, you know, he's got nothing else to do all day except just sit down there and write whatever he wants to write, and he's got it all formed in his head. He doesn't have the distraction of dealing with a day job, right? Whereas the rest of us do, and it can be bad enough if you're trying to pick up a piece of writing like the following day, you know, if you can only do a bit of writing for, you know, 1 or 2 hours a day or whatever it is, it's really important that you're able to retain where you're going with the plot or the characters or whatever in your head, at least to a degree. I still believe that there's a lot you can do by effectively pantsing. There's I think he's the most prolific author on earth. It's not George R. R. Martin. It's a guy called Dean Wesley Smith, an American guy called Dean Wesley Smith, who has written, let me get this right, I think it's something like 450 novels. Google him. If you've never heard of him, guys, Google him, Dean Wesley Smith. And he writes in all sorts of genres. He writes sci-fi, he writes romance, he writes thrillers, all sorts. And he's married to another highly prolific writer called Christine Catherine Rush, R-U-S-C-H, I think, Rush. Who is, you know, the female equivalent of Dean Wesley Smith, which is just as well, because otherwise I can't imagine how they'd live together. They'd never see one another, right? So so he's kind of the ultimate pantser, and he's written a lot of really useful short books on how he does it. And I've seen him write a novel, a 60,000-word novel, in a week, right? Extraordinary. Yeah, yeah, I saw you. Folks at home, Jonathan's eyebrows just went way up. But yeah, I've seen. But I know that's possible because, you know, I know for sure I can write 5,000 to 7,000 words a day if I'm really motoring along. So yeah, there you go, in the space of a week. And that's how he did it. He sat and he smacked out. I don't think he got a lot of sleep, but I think he's the kind of person who doesn't sleep a lot anyway. But man, he's a multimillionaire. You know, you can't argue with that. So, coming back to my story, I'd kind of re-outlined the story. And then I sat down, I thought, right, well, I kind of know, now I know who this character is. And I'm much happier with the lead character. And I need to kind of get the story started and give it a setting and give it a purpose and that kind of stuff. So I sat down and wrote the first chapter. And that was, well, it was actually now probably about 3 or 4 months ago. That's how much time flies, isn't it? And just as I'd finished that first chapter, and it's pretty much a first draft, I might have gone through it and, you know, edited out typos and that kind of stuff, but pretty raw, really. There was a thing came up. There's a group of, I mean, initially it was all women, but I think it now includes men. There's a group of independent authors here in the UK called Triskele Books. Triskele, T-R-I-S-K-E-L-E, Triskele Books, and that's a Celtic word. It's some sort of Celtic symbol, Triskele. But anyway, they are an independent author collective. Because one of the problems when you're an independent, you know, self-published author is it can be a really, really lonely road. So what it is a group of very highly talented people. And as I say, initially it was just women. I think they're all authors. I know one of them, Jane Dixon Smith, is also a graphic designer who designs beautiful book covers and internal layouts. So, and another one of them, I think, has done a lot of editing work. So they kind of, you know, when one of them finishes a book, they send it first to their other pals in this collective who check it and proofread it and edit it and, you know, that kind of stuff. And then Jane, I think, designs all the book covers. And then they help market it together. And man, it's been really successful. I mean, I think they've been going, now I could say for example, precisely how many, maybe 5 to 10 years. And in fact, they're just about next month in London putting on their first literary festival in central London, which is, wow, it's quite a big thing. And they managed to invite loads of, you know, really very well-known authors to talk about their books and how they write and all this kind of stuff. So anyway, they run regular competitions, and one of the competitions they run every year is, they call it their first page prize, which is basically you send in the first page of your novel, and they all kind of assess it, and the winner gets £500, and the second place £100, and the third place £50, and then there's a shortlist. So anyway, it was just on a whim. This competition came out, and I thought, well, you know, I need some kind of indication as to whether I should tie this novel. You know, if it's crap, tell me now, kind of thing. And well, last Friday, the results came back in, and it turned out that I was shortlisted. I was in the top, I think it's about 12 out of something like 400 entries. So you can imagine I was a bit pumped about that. And that's kind of given me a heavy hint that I should carry on writing this damn thing, you know. So I've got, you know, chapter one and an outline. I need to finish this puppy. So, yeah, that's... I think a lot of people who know me might be surprised. Oh, Henry, fantasy novel? What's that? Actually, I've been a fan of fantasy fiction since, well, blimey, at infant school or junior school, we read The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe by C.S. Lewis. And then in my early teens, what was I, 12, 13, 14, something like that, I read The Lord of the Rings for the first time and The Silmarillion and The Unfinished Tales and all the rest of it. And in fact, I was chatting with a friend of mine the other day. When I did my year abroad as part of my university degree in Augsburg in Germany, it turns out that Augsburg University Library is world-renowned for its collection of works, but works about Tolkien. You know, I think there may even have been a course there on Tolkien studies, that kind of stuff. And it included also all Tolkien's academic work, because he was a philologist that, you know, studied ancient languages, that kind of stuff. So all his, you know, Beowulf in the original Anglo-Saxon and, you know, I kind of got a fascination for that kind of thing a long, long time ago. But obviously, at the same time, I was doing a history degree. And military history has been a passion of mine as well since I've been a kid. You know, well, anyone who's read the Wargaming Compendium about that. So I've had this kind of parallel life where... simply because of the way my life and career has turned out, obviously I spent and still do spend the vast majority of my time looking at historical wargaming and historical, you know, military history. But underneath that, there's also this desire of mine to write fiction and specifically to write fantasy fiction. Because I'm really interested in myths and legends and lore and, you know, fantasy worlds and world creation. I think, you know, there's another a hint that people who have followed any of the stuff I've written about, like the Wars of the Falteenian Succession, right? It's set in the 18th century, but man, I could just as easily have made it a fantasy, completely fantasy world. obviously, because of my interest in the 18th century and the way that ties in with what Charles Grant did back in the day and all the rest of it, I have got this interest in creating worlds in historical, in inverted commas, historical periods, but in completely invented settings. So, you know, it's only a step away from for me to create entire worlds for a more, if you like, sounds weird, doesn't it? A more conventional fantasy setting, you know, a kind of sword and sorcery kind of setting. But it's not, you know, my intention is you're probably not going to meet elves and dwarves and hobbits in my world. My world is, and again, I better put this in inverted commas, much more realistic. It's much more gritty. It's much more kind of recognizably historically kind of medievalish, or early medieval at least. There's a writer who's dead now, sadly, called David Gemmell, who wrote a fantastic book called Druss the Legend. Many of your listeners, their ears may well be pricking up at this point, because he sadly died a few years ago, but he was an amazing kind of epic fantasy writer. But his stuff is it's really gritty. You know, it's much more like George R.R. Martin, actually. He doesn't pull any punches. You know, there's a lot of blood on the carpet. But his heroes are real gritty, plausible, believable heroes who you can, I feel I can identify more with. You know, they're not clean and shiny, well bathed, they don't shave very often kind of thing. They are facing their demons in a way that, you know, most of us, as we go through life from time to time, have to face our demons. You know, that we may not actually be standing in front of a dragon or you know, a horde of angry invaders, but we've all got our own demons to slay. You know, we've got bank managers to deal with and that kind of thing. So that's the kind of thing I write. And as I say, on my blog, people can read that first page because on the Triskele Books website, they posted the first, second, and third place stories, first pages, but not the kind of runners-up in the rest of the shortlist. So I posted mine on my personal blog, my non-wargaming blog at henryhyde.co.uk. So people can go and read it. And they may like it, they may hate it, but that's the nature of storytelling, isn't it? That if you try and write to please everyone, you won't please anyone. So there we go.
Well, I got to say, I was very surprised when I first heard inklings that you were interested in writing this kind of stuff. But it's funny because a while back I read an amazing fantasy novel, which you may have read. It got nominated for the Hugo and the Locus Award, and I think even the Nebula. It's called The Goblin Emperor, which is kind of a mix of high fantasy, but a lot of court intrigue. So it uses this half-breed goblin who becomes the emperor, and to talk about issues of race and slavery and elitism versus those who don't have anything. And he really is interested in kind of fixing all these things, whereas the previous elven emperors had no interest in it at all. So the fact that he's a goblin doesn't really matter. It could take place anywhere. And when I read this, I thought, you know, this is a world that is as rich as the stuff that you create. And in my mind, I thought, you know, if Henry ever wrote something like this, I could easily see your name on the cover instead of the author's name who wrote it, just because of it has a lot of that style of what some people I know like to call the fancy wars. So I thought it's very Faultenian Succession-esque in setting and kind of verging a little bit on steampunk sort of stuff a little bit. There's, you know, they're trying to build a steam bridge because it got destroyed and so forth. But it just like really rich characters with very everyday kind of problems, even though this guy, this goblin, he's an emperor, but very real threats of people trying to kill him and what does he do? And, everyday lives of people, but kind of shrouded in this whole world and these greater problems. So I can understand why this particular work did so well. And so after reading this and then many, many, many months later, seeing that you were interested in this kind of stuff, although I was shocked at first, I said, you know what? It makes perfect sense. Just by reading some of the stuff you've done with the imaginations, you are a very gifted world creator and world builder. And that's something you mentioned earlier about people buying some of those older issues of battle games. I will often tell people if they have any interest in kind of creating their own scenarios and their own settings or things, they need to read, I think it's your first 10 issues, where you really lay out how you created your worlds of Prunkland and Faultenland and what you've done with that. And I still use that today with stuff that I do, just kind of creating maps and that sort of stuff. I refer to what you've done there to try to help create the setting and everything, because I think you've done it so well and so concisely, and it's very easy to use and follow. Knowing that you want to do more fiction makes perfect sense to me.
Sure. It's also interesting you say that, because actually that compilation I did of the Wars of the Faultenian Succession has, I think, now become my best-selling issue. And I still see, pretty much on a daily basis, you know, one or two people have, you know, they trawl through the issues and then seen that compilation I did of the Wars of the Faultenian Succession stuff. And gone, well, you know, that looks like good value, because they're interested in that kind of world creation stuff. I think when, you know, this is where it starts to touch on wargaming, because obviously most of our discussion today has veered well away from wargaming, and probably there are some people who've tuned in and going, well, hang on a minute, I thought this show's called Wargaming Recon. And it is, you know, and alongside this, I am a wargamer. Part of the wargaming I've done in it, fantasy, not so much science fiction. That's interesting, because I love sci-fi. And, you know, if someone said to me straight off, you know, what's your favorite kind of movie, I would probably say sci-fi movies. You know, the new Star Wars, Star Trek and Star Wars and Aliens and, you know, The Martian, and, you know, back and back and back and back. You know, I like hard sci-fi. Battlestar Galactica is the remade version, is my, you know, one of my favorite TV series of all time. Had a bit of a wobble in series four, but basically it's, you know, superb. Serenity / Firefly, that was stupidly cancelled by the studios, you know, that may well actually be my favorite series of all time. And of course, sadly, it was series singular. But so I love all this stuff. But for some reason, reproducing sci-fi stuff in a war game, it's just, for whatever reason, hasn't turned me on. Warhammer 40K never turned me on. I've recently had a game of Hammer Slammers. It was in the latest issue of Miniature War Games. Had a game, my first ever game of Hammer Slammers with John Treadaway, which I found really interesting because it's actually kind of sci-fi, but not very, if that makes any sense to you. It's because essentially what it is, it's Vietnam in space. It's, you know, you've got these guys, the Hammer Slammers, and they're kind of an elite mercenary armored unit who get to do all the dirty jobs. And so they're taking on partisans and rebels and terrorists. And, you know, there are some other more formal forces. And they drive around, you know, one of the most kind of noticeable things is the tanks are mostly kind of hover tanks. They have large wheeled vehicles, but when you see a tank, instead of it having tracks, it's like a hovercraft with a gun on top. Interesting concept, because of course it makes it an all-terrain vehicle. So anyway, I had a go and it was really interesting. You know, in the article that John wrote for the John Treadaway wrote for the latest issue of the magazine, he mentioned, you know, that Henry was slightly taken aback by the suicide bombers. Well, yeah, we don't have many of those in the Wars of the Valtinian Succession. You know, you don't get many of them on the battlefield at Blenheim, right? It was considered not the done thing. So when I was playing this game and suddenly realized I couldn't trust a single vehicle, and there were a lot of vehicles, I couldn't trust a single parked vehicle in this game. Well, I started doing what the American forces started doing in Iraq, which is like, blow that car to pieces, you know, just stay 100 yards away and just turn your gun on it. If it makes a big bang, there was something nasty inside it, right? And it's just as well we didn't discover it with our guys on foot. And that's what I started doing, and ended up winning the game as a result. You know, John was pretty miffed I hadn't walked into any of his traps. But anyway, so that was fascinating. But sci-fi as a genre for wargaming, as I say, it's just computer games, yes. I think, you know, there are some amazing, you know, computer games and online games out there where you really do feel like, man, I am flying through space. And I think that's the thing that, for me, it's kind of the space combat is what turns me on, and that feeling of almost like being in a simulator, because I always loved flight simulators. That feeling that I can fly anywhere in this thing, and right? And so that's interesting. But fantasy, yeah, God, I was playing Dungeons & Dragons back in, I'm trying to remember, my first game of Dungeons & Dragons was probably when I was at university, so it would have been about 1979, 1980, something like that. But I'd actually had my first Middle-earth war game at school a couple of years before that, when I was, I don't know, about 15 or 16. So that would have been, oh my God, here we go, probably about 1976, 1977. Oh, I'm so old, Jonathan, I'm so old. So yeah, I'd already associated playing games with forces that weren't perhaps human, that maybe were goblins or orcs or hobbits or dwarves or elves or whatever. And so then when I came out the other side, then of course the birth of Games Workshop, you know, let's not go into that history again, but obviously I bought, in fact, I think I bought Hero Quest, Advanced Hero Quest, before I bought any of the Warhammer Fantasy Battle stuff. It, you know, but soon after I must have a Fantasy Battle, which must have been like something like that, really early on. And loved it. And, you know, actually, I might have mentioned this before somewhere online, but my thing was Skaven. I fell in love with the Skaven as an army because I just love the idea of Ratmen with all their mad weapons that, you know, blew up as much as they were successful. But if they were successful, they were really successful. And I think the Doom Wheel, the Skaven Doom Wheel, the original Skaven Doom Wheel is still my favourite thing ever in Warhammer Fantasy Battle. But anyway, I digress. So, yeah, so that's why I've always... The other thing is, I suppose because I've always been interested in historical wargaming and ancient history and, you know, the 18th century stuff, obviously fantasy wargaming, there's an obvious crossover between ancient and medieval wargaming and fantasy battle. Is the armor with swords and shields and axes and that kind of stuff. So essentially, you've got battle in which some non-human characters are often involved. Plus, you've got this weird artillery that comes from wizards, right? Because that's how you can look at wizards, isn't it? You know, and spellcasters, is that it's a kind of artillery. You know, they can fire a lightning bolt hundreds of yards into the middle of a melee or something and wipe people out. Well, yeah, take away the wizard, put in a large cannon, it's pretty much the same thing. Obviously, there are other things to do with spell casting that, you know, we're all familiar with from Dungeons and Dragons, the notion that you could heal people, you could resurrect the dead, or you could suddenly inflict the plague on a load of people. But essentially, you know, if you played medieval war games, you've got no problem, or should have no problem, translating that experience across into fantasy battle gaming or skirmish gaming, fantasy skirmish gaming, because it's essentially exactly the same thing. Yeah, you know, particularly if you look at Lord of the Rings, where, you know, quite often the wizards were missing. You know, the Battle of the Two Towers, I mean, Mithrandir turns up eventually with the cavalry, with the Rohirrim cavalry, but, you know, there's most of that battle is just a slugfest siege kind of scenario that anyone who's played ancient or medieval games would recognise. So that's also where, when it comes to writing, I feel like I've got something to say. You know, when it comes to the battle scenes and fight scenes, I can bring something to the party, you know, in writing a novel. Because also I've done reenactment as well. You know, I think we've talked about this before. I was in the SCA. So, you know, I've smacked a few people around the head with a big chunk of wood, and I've been smacked around the head quite a few times with a big chunk of wood. I've heard, you know, I've been inside a helmet that literally has rung when someone's hit it, you know. My shield split in half, you know, When you've got that kind of experience, both at a nitty-gritty level, you know, you're literally looking through an eye slit and that's what you can see, up to the big, grand tactical level, you know, well, let's send a brigade of orcs in on the left flank. I think that's quite useful as a writer. And obviously there's people like Gav Thorpe, who's written a lot of novels for... what do they call themselves? Black Library, which is the Games Workshop publishing arm. And he's written loads. I mean, he's written about 50 novels now, all based in the Warhammer universe, which is interesting. I couldn't stand doing that, but obviously for him it's provided, well, effectively it's all provided him with a day job, you know. I need to get to meet him because he's, you know, he's obviously extremely prolific, so I'm sure he's got lots of tips to give. But I wonder how, you know, does he find it liberating that he hasn't had to come up with a universe himself, or does he find it confining? And does he actually wish, you know, God, if I've got to write another Warhammer 40K novel, I'm going to cut my own head off with a spoon, right? You don't know, do you? On the other hand, he might love it. Obviously, you know, he probably loves getting paid for it. So that's kind of the writing thing, Jonathan, and that's where it came from. So yeah, this thing just the other day, where literally it's like, wow, someone not only noticed that I'd written something, but they thought highly enough of it to put in on a very short list out of a lot of entries. So I was, you know, the £500 first prize would have been nice, but you know, that comes down to the individual taste of the people judging it. And that's the nature of competitions. You know, you might enter one and come nowhere and enter another one and, you know, win first prize. But just, you know, also this is the other thing. That's the first writing competition of any kind I've entered since I was at school. So, you know, so crikey. And it's like for 40 years. 40 years, Jonathan. How old are you, Jonathan?
Since not old enough.
You were born. before you were born,
you might be interested with your background way back in D&D. I'm not sure if you're aware, but Wargaming Recon is actually part of the TSR podcast network, which is owned by TSR Games, and that has the affiliation with Gary Gygax's sons, yeah, who were involved, but then also Frank Mentzer, yeah, and Tim Kass, who did Dragon Magazine, and Frank Mentzer, who did, I think it's a Red Box. So I actually get to see Frank and Tim every year when I go to TotalCon. They're guests of honor there, and I get to go to behind the scenes, kind of off the books sort of events and things I'm not allowed to talk about, but really interesting stories about the early days and what it was like to work with Gary and the early days of creating D&D and all that kind of stuff. And again, the world building and the game design and all that kind of stuff. And I tell you, they are amazing people. Just a lot of knowledge there with them. And I'm actually very grateful. And I don't even quite know how it happened that Wargaming Recon's now, you know, become part of the TSR podcast network. It's interesting that, you know, I got to figure it out because I'm sure I know somehow how I said yes at one point. I know I did that, but like this is their wargaming podcast is what it is. And so it's interesting having those kind of connections. And you might also find it interesting. One thing I like to do in every show, I like to have the mailbag section of the show where listeners can hear their feedback that they've sent in. And some of it, I think, will be of particular interest to you, basically from things that I've seen you post on Facebook. But before I dive right into that, I just want to say we had a couple bits of email from listeners. I had one from listener Mike, who was actually talking about my episode before this. It was the 10 years of Wargaming Recon, who he just kind of said, good luck. It sounds like it's going to be a good one. And then someone who you are very well acquainted with also sent an email in. Neil Shook, also for that episode, said, really well done on 10 years. And for people who listen to that episode, the episode 165, I hope you listen to the end because there's an audio message from Neil in there, which is very nice to that he actually took the time to do. And I know he's so busy and I don't quite know how he managed to do it. But there's a game designer who, Henry, you might be familiar with, and I'm honestly not sure if you are or not, but I think you know his work maybe more than the name. Russ Lockwood, does that ring a bell with you, Henry?
Oh, yeah, that rings bells, yeah. I've not met him, but yes.
From MagWeb, and he's done Snappy Nappy and a bunch of... Anyway, he's been on the show in the past. I think he's going to be coming on sometime in 2017. He has a couple new things coming out, including something he can't tell me much about just yet, but he's promised he's going to share as soon as he can. But he actually sent me an email as well, also for episode 165, and he said, congratulations on reaching the 10-year milestone. Always enjoy chatting with a knowledgeable host. Keep up the good work. And then on Facebook, this is going to lead me into something that I think will be of particular interest to you. You have a very strong interest in giving back. And it's one of the things I really enjoy seeing that you do. And it's something I'm passionate about as well. The charity that I kind of work with, the Extra Life Foundation, they work with different area children's hospitals to make sure that there's funding there for kids who have need of medical treatments for things like cancer and cystic fibrosis and that kind of stuff. But these kids, they don't have the money for it. The families can't afford to pay it. And they're not going to get the treatment if they don't have the funds. So this charity makes sure the funds are there. I don't even quite know how they decided to contact me, but for some reason they ended up contacting me, this Extra Life charity, and they wanted to make sure that I knew, and I'm sharing with all the listeners, because the listeners here actually have done a lot to help with fundraising for this charity. Yep. And I'm very appreciative for everything that people have done. But Extra Life has said, quote, over the past 4 years, you've raised and donated over $1,500 for sick and injured kiddos. You're a rock star. And I actually think they mean the listeners are a rock star, because it's because of all of you that we have done so well. And a couple listeners are doing something too. And I think it's probably a larger UK kind of awareness sort of thing. So I was first made aware of this new thing by Stuart Foley from paintedwargamefigures.co.uk. He's known on Facebook as the Jolly Frog Figure Company. Excuse me. Dave, who is a listener from War Games at Battleshades Facebook group. And then Alyssa Faden, who you might be familiar with, Henry. She does a lot of cartography. You've seen, I'm sure.
Yeah, fantastic stuff. Yeah.
Torn Armor and all. She's coming on the show in a future episode. But all of them had made me aware of something that you're involved with, which is the 22 Push-Up Challenge to raise awareness for PTSD and vets' mental health needs. I was told by Stuart, and I can't say that I validated the figure, but the stat seems true, that every day 22 former Army, Navy, and Air Force members take their lives due to PTSD. So I told all of them I would make a point of, first of all, mentioning it on the show. And I know you've been doing your 22 push-ups a day. So I want to say I've enjoyed seeing that. And I hope other people are seeing this and helping to spread the word and making donations to combat stress to help those vets who are in dire need of some treatment over there.
Yeah, I have to point out that it's not, well, the British version anyway, is not doing 22 push-ups every single day. I think that would be too much for some people. I think you just have to do it once and then make a donation to the charity, you know, the military mental health charity, which in the UK is, of course, Combat Stress. So, yes, I did my bit. I did my 22 push-ups. And some people, when they've done theirs, they nominate other people to do it. I just said, look, you know, come on, pull yourself together and go and do your own 22 push-ups challenge. Yeah, it's okay. I mean, I think it's a it's an awful statistic, a tragic statistic. And I think that's quite a clever way of using that for something positive. And I know that Combat Stress in the UK, at least, have had tremendous success with it. There is a specific charity in the States as well, isn't there, that focuses on mental health of veterans rather than just kind of physical injuries, that kind of stuff. But anyway, the Veterans Association or whatever it might be, you know, obviously that they use the money, you know, it goes to a tremendous cause. So come on, everyone, get down and do your 22 push-ups. You can see mine on YouTube. I have a YouTube channel which you can dig around and find, or it was also on the, did I put it on the Miniature War Games Facebook page? I think I did. Just do your 22 push-ups. Give £5 to combat stress or whatever and, you know, move on.
And then I have a few announcements in, as I'd like to say, pay the bills kind of stuff that I also think you might be interested in, Henry. There's a new Kickstarter that I think you, I know you love making your maps, but I think you might like this because I have you in mind whenever I think of this product. It's called Hexographer 2. It's a computer program that is very easy to use that allows you to make hex based. Do you have the original right
now? I have to see what other people are up to. And I subscribe to their newsletter, so I heard that they would this version.
Well, the creator of it's going to be coming on the show. They're doing really well with the Kickstarter. I don't know if you've been following it. They're hoping to raise $15,000, which they've done. They've reached 4 of their stretch goals now. So there's going to be extra icons. There's going to be extra features for, like, if you're doing medieval and you want castles, it'll auto-generate, like, information about the castle or a town or all that kind of stuff. So you can have, obviously, if you're like someone like Henry, you're going to want to add that stuff in yourself because you want to have, you're creating your own world, but the software for, I've used the first one, is amazing. For someone like me who doesn't have any of these kind of creative skills for design. If I were to draw you a hex, you would laugh and you'd kick me out on the street. Is what I make stick figures look bad. Okay, so it's true. Something like this is very useful for someone like me. I've used it for historicals. You can use it for role-playing games, whatever you kind of stuff you want. You can actually use it like a board game almost to play your game. Like if you want to play Command and Colors, instead of doing that, you can get this. You can have a GM. Certain parts of the map can be made visible to players so you can see, and you can put your units and things like that. It's very, very cool. You can get in at a low level, I think. You can still get in and get all the cool extras and stuff. They're going to be on the show. Actually, I don't know when they're going to be on. I think maybe the next episode. I might need to check that. Oh, and then because it kind of helps for me to know when I got to be where I need to be, oddly enough. And otherwise, people tune in and there's nothing. Just black screen.
Yeah.
It might be a little disappointing, right? People looking for that new issue of Miniature War Games, and you're just on vacation somewhere. Like, what issue of Miniature War Games? They're not going to be too happy about that. But we've talked about passive income throughout the show a little bit. And one of the ways that I'm able to bring the show to all of you is you would think a podcast shouldn't cost money or not much, right? It should be pretty cheap. And I've, much to my own chagrin, found that's not true. Surprise. And now that I have a child and things like that, less money for this and more money for that. So one of the ways that I'm able to keep the lights on, so to speak, is by having a sponsor. So I'm very appreciative for the Maine Historical Wargamers Association. They put on Huzzah every year, which is one of my favorite historical wargaming conventions. It's up in Portland, Maine, 15th through the 21st, 2017. And Henry, I know in the past when you were doing battle games as your own solo independent endeavor, you were able to offer prize support and things like that for their raffles, and how appreciative they've all been for that. And I know they're kind of doing stuff with War Game Soldiers and Strategy, and they've made connections with War Games Illustrated and all that kind of stuff. They're a great group of people. They also like to give back. They try to use wargaming to teach kids about all sorts of different things, social aspects and kind of stuff. So they do a lot of outreach up in Maine for that kind of stuff. So it's a great group. And I'm just very appreciative that they've decided to say, hey, we're going to give you a little money here for Wargaming Recon and to help out and that kind of stuff. I will be actually, I'll be at Huzzah in 2017. I'll be doing a live show, which would be pretty cool.
Oh, cool.
Then we talked about Patreon. So Patreon for me is the other piece of the puzzle, and actually it's becoming more and more the larger chunk of the puzzle. So the sponsorship is great, and I'd love to have more sponsors if it's a right fit. But it's really cool to have support from listeners like you, because any one of you who's listening, I presume you're listening because you like the show and you like what we do here. You like having guests like Henry on, which is really cool. We can't do it without paying for things like web hosting and all that kind of stuff, equipment and being able to go to places. So having support from backers is huge. So I have to thank some backers here. I need to thank Patrick. I need to thank Chris Parker from Day of Battle Games, Kyle from Vermont, who is our newest backer, and also Dave and the War Games at Battleshades Facebook group for their support. I have many different backer levels here. You can get in for as little as $1 a month. That gets you all the episodes before everyone else, behind the scenes content and cool stuff. And then I have other levels. One of the levels is I thank you by name on every episode of the show. You can also get for $18 a month, I will mail to you a set of 6 custom Wargaming Recon wooden discs, the G6. They're laser engraved. They were done by Christopher, who is another Havoc and Azza. And this is one that I really like. And I really enjoy it because I think it's terrible that the only mail we get nowadays is junk mail and bills. I like that although people don't write letters anymore, I can do my part and I can do postcards. So for the certain backer level every month, I'll send you a Wargaming Recon postcard, and on the back, you know, I'll write messages about what's going on. We can chat and cool stuff. I just think it's nice to get mail that's not trash and not saying you owe us money. Call me weird, but I think it's kind of neat. So I enjoy going to the post office and saying, here's my postcards to send out to people. So it's pretty cool to do all of that. And I would say what date the next episode is, except you would think I'd be more... Actually, I can tell you. It's September 12th. will be the next episode of Wargaming Recon, and that's actually when I'm going to talk about Hexographer 2. Henry, did you end up backing the Kickstarter, or are you going to wait and see how things go with it before you do anything?
No, I'm going to wait to see, because also it's something I was interested in to see how to do it, but obviously the way that it generates terrain is completely different from the way I render my terrain and stuff. But it's certainly, because I get asked a lot, Henry, how do you do your maps? You know, whether it's the big maps for the campaigns or the battlefield maps and stuff. And so I say, yeah, well, I use Adobe Photoshop. And they say, oh, yeah, well, I'm not going to pay, you know, £45 a month to have the Creative Cloud software. So how else could I do the map? And, you know, there is no cheap and easy way to do what I do. But if what you want is a cheap and easy map, well, there are these other things. There's kind of about half a dozen bits of software, of which Hexographer, I think it's fair to say, is one of the most superior ones. So I've obviously been keeping tabs on it, and was very interested to see that they were kind of upgrading it. And certainly for anyone who wants to create a fantasy campaign, but doesn't feel like they either have the talent or the time to do what I do, man, use Hexographer. Really, it's a no-brainer.
I've kind of done a hybrid version of what you did with your Faultenian Succession in the software. So I'll go through and I roll the dice. I generate a blank map in Hexographer in the first one. I roll the dice and do all that stuff. And I add it in. So I do part analog and part digital. And then after it's all created, I use the digital and continue with it from that way. Just because, like I said, I don't have the talent like you do to go in and create all the great maps. And you touched on it, but we should say again, for people who are interested in Gladius Publications and your mailing list, they get two cool, really free gifts. One of them I've printed out. That's actually a boring picture if you're watching on our video, on our live stream. So these are your terrain map squares, and I printed these out on 110-pound cardstock. It works just fine on a LaserJet or inkjet printer. I think they look pretty good. And then you also have, as your other gift, this is your scenario maps, which are kind of cool. Just kind of a quick peek. They look really good. And I mean, of course they do. But again, printed out on 110-pound cardstock. So you could cut them out and make your own maps. And if you blew them up really large, you could really do a very, very, I'm going to say, old school kind of table. So you get that out and you use that until you want to make 3D terrain, or maybe you don't. You just use that, and they look really, really nice. And
The idea of the scenario maps was that I kind of stripped away all the other unnecessary details, so people could, even though some of them might have been used for a horse and musket game or a World War II game initially, it's just to show people that, you know, just with a bit of imagination, you can use any map for any historical period or fantasy or sci-fi. And, you know, there's just a few examples. I'm actually working on my first book of scenarios, which would probably be World War II scenarios, that are going to be fairly generic, which is to say they're not going to be specifically for Flames of War or Rapid Fire or any specific rule set. The idea being that, you know, here's a situation. You've got a platoon of infantry and the other side has got, you know, a platoon of infantry and a couple of tanks or something like that. You've got to take that town in the middle. Off you go. Because I think for a lot of people, you know, if they go to a war games club, quite typically, or they might get together with a friend or two for an evening's gaming, what they don't want to do is to turn up and then spend the first hour just thinking, well, you know, what should we play? What should we do? What scenario should we have? So the idea is, look, here's your scenario. Here's the terrain you need. Set it up quickly and crack on with your game. And I think, you know, there's quite a big market of scenario books these days, and which is one of the things that made me think, well, duh, that's something I can do quite easily and produce attractive maps as well. The idea of the terrain squares is, again, they can be used in two different ways. The first way is you can create your own scenario map using those terrain squares. And the same, they're based on terrain squares. You know, those Total System Scenic you know, polystyrene terrain squares. That's the basic idea. So you slap a few of those together, bung some trees on top and some houses and your troops and off you go. And the idea is that it was lovely to see you have actually printed them out on card, because obviously what you can do is cut them out and then you can actually arrange them on the tabletop before getting out your terrain squares, or use those and then use terrain from any other source. You know, you might have rubber roads and your own trees and stuff, but that's a good way of setting things up. They can also be used for a campaign, a small campaign. They can even be used by a solo wargamer. You know, you can spend an hour kind of discovering terrain as you go along, literally by shuffling the cards up, print them out multiple times. So you shuffle the cards up and then draw them one at a time, and that's the next bit of terrain that you've discovered. Or you could draw them two at a time, so you're advancing more each time. And I'm actually working on another one, which is specifically for campaign generation, that could be used solo or could be used by two players. So it would literally be, the cards will tell you not only what terrain your scouts are discovering as they advance, but also encounters with the enemy, which should mean, I mean, this is partly tying in with my campaigns book that I'm writing for Pen and Sword. The idea being that you can play a completely solo campaign if you like, and it should be entertaining and enjoyable, you know, as a kind of card-based game. So there you are, Jonathan. That's kind of as much as I can say about me at the moment, and I need to go have my dinner.
I know we're wrapping up, but can you say how much further you have to go before you can finish that campaigns book, before we'll be able to get it in our hands?
I'm at the very rough first draft stage, and well, because of all the things that have happened recently, I'm not giving any specific things. I mean, Pen and Sword, I'm hoping to get that, certainly the main first draft, all finished by the end of this year. If it goes better than that, that's fantastic. You know, if I actually manage to get the design and layout done as well, I'll be over the moon about that. If nothing else, I can get it off my back. And I'm sure Pen and Sword will be over the moon as well. But I'm not going to be stupid and make any specific promises, because I've got so many irons in the fire at the moment, so many pies in the oven. But that's my intention, is to have the campaigns book finished, written by the end of this year, and therefore it would be published sometime in 2017. So, you know, I had really hoped that I wouldn't be writing another book that would take me 4 years. But the reality is that, you know, the Wargaming Compendium that's behind your head there took about 4 years to write. And my life, you know, because my life was tumultuous. And I blithely thought I was much calmer now. Quite like that, hasn't it? So there we are. It's a wargaming book every 4 years, folks. That seems to be my rate of production. But I mean, we're talking about these are the big ones, and then the next ones after that are going to be based on my Shot, Steel and Stone rules, the books for Pen and Sword. So there's definitely going to be the full horse and musket version as a standalone work of some description. And I set up a Facebook group where we are discussing Ancients variations, English Civil War variations, American Civil War variations. You know, it's that's one of the benefits of having designed, if you like, a rule system, is that immediately becomes apparent that you can make adaptations to make it fit, you know, pretty much any period from ancient times up to probably, you know, colonials would be the last thing, or the late wars in Europe, kind of 1870 or thereabouts. You know, once modern mechanized warfare comes in, it's completely different, because you need different rules mechanisms to cope with that, simply because of modern rates of fire are so much higher, movements are so much faster, and, you know, aeroplanes and long-range artillery. But certainly, you know, I'd already, and I told this to someone else. Who did I tell this? Was it you? Was it Neil Shook? It might be Neil Shook on View from the Veranda. That actually, the first version of My Shots in Stone Rules was actually an Ancients version. But because of the deadline of the book, I switched to it being a Horse and Musky version simply because in ancient and medieval warfare, obviously you have so many different weapon and armor combinations that make it actually much more complicated than you might think to begin with. So whereas with in the horse and musket period, it's a bit like paper, scissors, stone, isn't it? That most infantry is pretty similar, most cavalry is pretty similar, most artillery is pretty similar with a few variations. But back in ancient times, obviously you might be up against someone who's got leather armor on, or canvas armor, or steel armor, or bronze armor, you know, with a huge range of weaponry as well. But the ancients, so that what that means is that probably after the horse and musket version, the next version will be the ancients version. And in fact, in secret, I've actually got at least a couple of guys doing some early playtesting on that. Hello, Jay. If Jay's listening, watching this, he is. So yes, I've already got encouragement to get an ancients version out, and because of my own gaming. You may have seen in the magazine that I've plunged headfirst into the English Civil War in 10mm. So, man, I'd better get an English Civil War version of my rules working as soon as possible. So there we go. So, yeah, lots happening, lots of irons in the fire. But the main thing is I need to start earning some money from Gladius.
Well, if listeners want to stay up to date with what you're doing with that and everything, what's the best way for them to stay current?
Oh, very simple. They can go to gladiuspublications.com, which is the website. And we have a Facebook page, don't we? Gladius, I think it's Gladius Books is what it's called on Facebook. And it's at Gladius Books on Twitter, because there's a limit to how many characters you can have in a Twitter username, and Gladius Publications was far too long. So it's at Gladius Books on Twitter. And yeah, so they all tie in, because I think I now have four split personalities on Twitter, because I have at Battle Games, I have at Miniature WG, which is Miniature War Games, I have at Gladius Books, and I have at Henry_Hyde as well. So yeah, probably what I should do is just merge them all, smush them all together, but I think it helps sometimes when you're running in business terms to keep kind of separate things separate. But yeah, that's kind of where I can be found. And just you, if you see me at a show, just come up and poke me, you know, that's that'll do.
Well, it's been a pleasure having you on this episode of Wargaming Recon, Henry. I'm so glad you were able to fit it in. I know how busy you are, and it sounds like you're even busier. So thank you for taking the time to come on with us here. It's been a pleasure, as always.
You're welcome, Jonathan. It's been a pleasure for me, and thank you for having me.
Well, I want to remind everyone that you can get the show notes for this episode by visiting wargamingrecon.com/WR166. That's wargamingrecon.com/WR166. Well, I'm sure all my listeners are going to be excited about Gladius Publications, and no matter how busy you are, no matter what's going on in your lives, you know you have to, you gotta, you need to keep on gaming.